worship you. I worship you. I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. Yeah, I see.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We're glad to be in the house of God tonight. Thank you so much for those that are in-house with us, for being here with us, and those that have joined us on live feed. Thank you so much for joining with us. We do have some that are connected to the church that are sick. We have some that are going to be having surgery tomorrow, some that's been going through some stuff and possibly surgery in the next couple of weeks, so need to definitely keep them in our prayers. Other prayer requests has been posted on the prayer wall. Be sure to check that out and pray for each one as God leads them on your heart to pray for them. We want God to move and minister in their lives. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. If you're in-house and have a prayer request, let be known by lifting your hand. God knows every need. All those that are able, let's all stand. Those that are on live stream, you can text the keyword prayer to 205-642-8744. We want to partner together with you in prayer. Amen. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we come to you today again, thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity that you've allowed us to come into your house to worship and praise you. Father, tonight you've heard the request. You've seen the uplifting of the hands. You see those, every need, every heart and every life. And Father, I pray that you'll move and minister in a mighty way. Touching this service tonight, you see those in our kids' class, those in our teens, young adults, those here in the sanctuary, those that are joined us on live stream. Father, I pray you would move and minister in a mighty way. Open the windows of heaven and pour out an anointing and a blessing upon this time of praise and worship and this time of Bible study. Father, I pray that you would move and minister in a mighty way this very day, this very hour. We forever give you the praise, the honor, and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise and let's worship in song tonight. Amen.
Yes, if you'll get your hymn book, turn to page 205. We're singing a beautiful song about wonderful words of life. Page 205.
Sing them over and over to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the Blessed One gives to all wonderful words of life. Sinnerless to the loving call, wonderful words of life. All so freely given, wooing us to heaven. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Sweetly echoes a gospel call, wonderful words of life. Offer pardon and peace to all, wonderful words of life. Jesus, only Savior, sanctified forever. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life.
This next song is not in your hymn book, but you may find it familiar. It's His Grace is Sufficient for Me. I'm so thankful that every day that I have found the grace of God is right there, no matter what I'm going through, to see me through that very day. Yes.
Amen. Glory to God. Aren't you glad His grace is sufficient? Amen. Glory be to God. Amen. Again, we appreciate you being in the house of God tonight. Amen. Over the last couple of Wednesday nights, we've been talking about praying effectively, and looking into the Word of God and what that actually means and what that applies for in our lives. And so, we started off looking at praying effectively, and we talked about different aspects of prayer. We talked about how to pray. We didn't teach how to pray. We didn't look at how to pray. We looked at how to pray. It wasn't a how to pray and, okay, you remove this spark plug and you put a new, it wasn't anything of that nature of how to do it. It was, this is what praying is for. This is what praying is about. This is when we pray, this is what we're doing. This is the connection that we're making. We also looked through that aspect and learned that God made man to have a relationship with God. It was not supposed to be a separation. There is supposed to be a relationship. Over the past couple of weeks, been watching, you know, just scrolling through YouTube and looking at videos. And did y'all know there was some people out there in the world? If you did not know that, I'm just letting you know that right now. There is some strange folks out there in the world. Stop it. They some strange people in the world. Some of them But there are some strange people in the world. And did you know that there's actually people in the world that, this is going to shock you, there's people in the world that don't believe in God. They don't believe in God whatsoever. They believe that a cosmic being, a cosmic being miraculously, Did you just use the word miraculous and you don't believe in God? And so this is the thing that we've got to understand, is there's actually people out there that they don't believe in God, but yet they believe there is something missing in their life. When I walk out the front door, every guy in here is the same way about this that I am. Every girl in here is the same way about this, like my wife would be. When I walk out the front door, there are several things that will be somewhere on my body from here to my feet. My shoes will be on my feet, not my hands. In my pocket, there's going to be hand sanitizer. There's going to be, hang on, let's go over here, keys. There's always going to be an ink pen somewhere on me. There's going to be an ink pen, so that's going to be right there. Let me find, I got that. There's my cell phone, my wallet, all of that, and one or two other things going to be on me. But the point is, if I walk out the front door and I get somewhere and I don't have my ink pen on me, or I don't have my keys on me, or hand sanitizer, that I don't think that's ever happened. But if something's missing, then I feel like something is missing. I feel like something's missing. And I'm checking around and I'm trying to figure out what that something is. And then when I figure it out, I have to remedy what's missing. If it's an ink pen missing, I know I'm strange. I know I'm unusual. Everybody agrees with me. I know that. But the fact of it is if there's an ink pen is missing, I'm going to do something, Brother Kevin, to make sure I find my, get me an ink pen. I don't care if I had to get one, if I had to borrow one out of my truck, or if I have to stop at the church before I get too far, or I get somewhere and I say, give me an ink pen. We've even gone places and I say, oh, Lord have mercy, I ain't got my ink pen on me. My wife will hand me one out of her purse just so that I'll have, because that's just me. But the fact of it is, I tell you all that to say this, whenever we don't have God in our life, it's like something is missing. And these folks are walking around believing that God doesn't exist, believing that there's some cosmic power somewhere or another that puts all these things together, and they don't realize that that cosmic power is the God of heaven and earth. And what we've got to realize, I'm never trying to roam around about my relationship with God, because I know my relationship with God. But now, my ink pen may be missing. My wallet may be missing. My cell phone's my cell phone may not be on me. Something may be missing, but I don't have to worry about my relationship with God. Why? Because I know my relationship with God. But these folks that are like that, they are trying to figure out what is going on, what is happening, what is taking place, what's going on, because they're trying to figure out, hey, something's missing out of my life. There's a void there in my life. I need God to fill it. They don't believe in God, so wait a minute. They can't ask God to fill it. They believe something's missing, but they've got to have something to fill that. And so they'll go and they'll try to get this to fill it. And they don't actually get a hold of what is needed to fill that unless they hear about the plan of salvation. All of those things being said, all of those things happening, what we've got to realize and understand is God created man so that man and God would have a relationship. That's what God did. So talking about praying effectively, last Wednesday night, we left on this thought. We started looking at a few words. One of the words was, starting now, we're looking at praying intelligently. In order to pray effectively, we have got to pray intelligently. So to that end, we looked at a few words, and I want to go over these definitions one more time. Last Wednesday night, spent time going through these words. I'm not going to rehash everything last Wednesday night, but I want to
go back through just these definitions because this is going to lay a bigger foundation for tonight. So knowing that, we look at the words, these words, knowledge. We look at these words, knowledge. The first word is knowledge. The word knowledge literally means information acquired. Information acquired. Growing up, Dad wanted to make sure that we knew how to change the oil in our vehicles. Dad wanted us to make sure that we knew how to change the tires on our car. I know this is going to be very, nobody's going to find this humorous at all. But do you know, believe it or not, people, I had a flat tire one day and somebody looked at me and said, "You know how to change a flat tire?" I said, "Yeah, I know how to change a flat tire." Why? Because my dad, he wanted to make sure I had the knowledge, in other words, information acquired. Dad wanted to make sure that I knew how to change the oil, change the tire on my vehicle. Why? Because I needed that information. Knowledge is information acquired. It does not mean you know how to use the information. It just means information acquired. Wisdom, we also understand out of James chapter 1 and verse 5, we understand that wisdom is something that is only God-given. Wisdom is God-given. We see in James chapter 1 and verse 5, if you lack wisdom, ask God. He gives generously without reproach. It will be given if you ask God for wisdom. Wisdom is something that is God-given. Wisdom and intelligence are closely related. Wisdom is to have keen perception, show sound judgment, discern the truth, what is right, what is lasting. Wisdom is bestowed, can be bestowed for special tasks and purposes. Then the last word we looked at last Wednesday night was intelligence. We know that there are some people that lacks in, never mind. But the word intelligence is having the capacity to apply knowledge, have understanding, and the ability to apply what has been learned and experiences to new situations that is down to earth, common sense, that is using that wisdom and that knowledge to the best advantage that we can have. That is what intelligence is all about. Intelligence is taking that knowledge, taking that wisdom, and putting those, meshing those together and applying that to the new situations we face. How many of us, every day, you face something new? You face a new situation. There's some little nuance of it that's different, but there's something new in your life. You've never faced that before. I've never faced a mouse in this church before, in the office. I have faced mice in the bathrooms. I have faced mice upstairs. I walked into the room yesterday. I walked in. I knew exactly what it was. But the intelligence was, is I had to find that joker. That was the intelligence part. I had the wisdom. I had the information. I knew what it smelled like. I knew what was going to be happening, but I had to have the intelligence to find it. It didn't take much. Oop, there it is. No. There's a whole story behind that one. Anyhow, what we've got to understand is there is an aspect of this, of finding something new in every aspect of what we face every day. There's something new, right? That's worth that. Now, in our lives, every day when you get up, you may face something new as you go to work, as you go to school, as you go to the doctor, as you go wherever, whatever you face, there's something new. So what we've got to do is we've got to take what we've learned, our past experiences, everything about our life, and we've got to apply it to something new in our life. We've got to learn daily things about what God is wanting us to see in our life. So all of these things, take a look at Isaiah 28 and verse 10. Picking this back up right here, Isaiah 28 and verse 10. there's a lot of what's going on in this passage of Scripture. There's a lot what's happening in this passage of Scripture. I'm not going to get into all of the things that's happening in this. I want to just break down parts of this for us to understand, because we've got to understand, we're looking at praying effectively. We've looked at how to pray. Now we're looking at praying intelligently, okay? Praying intelligently. So knowing that, Isaiah 28 and verse 10, it says, For it is precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little. In other words, it's inch by inch, centimeter by centimeter, millimeter by millimeter. It's very slow moving pace. We're going to teach it as it comes. We're going to teach every aspect just a little bit at a time, just so that you can understand every precept by precept by precept by precept, line by line by line, here a little, there a little. What Jesus is saying, whenever he started, whenever the disciples came to him and said, "Hey, Lord, teach us how to pray. Teach us how to pray." Jesus did not want to just take the entire stack of encyclopedias and throw it at them. He wanted to teach them little by little, and teach them a little bit, they've learned that aspect. Teach them a little bit more, they learned that aspect. Teach them a little bit more, they learned that aspect. And then also remembering what they've already learned and building every day, every minute, every hour, building on what we learned a few moments ago. If we do that, then what Jesus is referring to, back to, when he goes back, he actually quotes this verse, he quotes aspects of this throughout times and scriptures, and he's trying to show them. This is why he used the parables. Somebody contacted me one time and said, "I don't understand parables. I don't understand parables." So I could have said, "Are you kidding me? Why don't you understand parables?" No, what we do is we step back and we said, "Okay, this is a parable." And so I'd use something that we know in our day and time today. We use what we're learning in today's time, and we build a parable off of what we understand today. We don't have the parable of the coin, or we don't have the parable of the fish. We don't have these different parables like what Jesus had. We have parables in our own time today based off of what we experience in our day and time today. It's not everything what we face today is a whole lot different than what they faced in Bible time, right? What we've got to realize and understand, the Bible was written to that particular time frame, that particular context, that particular area, that particular, everything about it was that time, but we take the Word of God and we apply it into our time today. Find me in the Bible anything about a cell phone. It's not there. Find me in the Bible anything about a television. It's not there. So that means that cell phones and televisions must be come from the devil, because it was not in the Bible. No, that's not what was said either. What we've got to realize and understand is we've got to take the Word of God and we've got to apply it into our lives. And how do we do that? Precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. You're not going to be able to open up and just dump everything into your mind. It's a little bit at a time, learning little bit by little bit, so that you can learn the whole Word of God. We've got to understand the word intelligence means well-versed, well-informed. Intelligence refers to the ability to effectively apply clear thinking, not emotional thinking, not knee-jerk reaction thinking, but clear thinking, good judgment to any problem, any situation. This is what intelligence is all about. We mentioned this last week. I've always been told military intelligence is a contradiction in terms. Why? Ask somebody that's been in the military. A lot of times they'll tell you that's why. There's a reason behind that. what we've got to understand is intelligence is using clear thinking, using clear judgment to tackle a problem or a situation. Intelligence is the power to reason, distinguish, gather information, gather insight, act accordingly to a situation. Intelligence is easily understanding what the problem is, clearly stating obvious, plain, clear, distinct. Intelligence is precisely practical terms of how to define the way one would pray, and it's the biblical way of doing things. I've said this before, and I know that I hope everybody believes I'm joking. I'm not joking about the fact that I don't like snakes. That's not a joke. I have said before, if I see a snake, I'm burning the house down. How intelligent would that be? Not very. Why? I can call somebody, they can get the snake out of the house. Hello. But if I burn the house down, guess what? All my clothes are gone now. Do you follow what I'm saying? So where's the intelligence in that? You're doing a, quote, knee-jerk reaction of, I seen a snake in the house, I'm burning the house down. That is the unclear part of the thinking process. What we've got to realize and get in our mindsets, just because I don't like snakes does not mean I burn the house down. Although I might want to. Right? What we've got to understand is a lot of times that's what God's trying to tell us to do. He says, stop and let's wait on God to move. I talked to somebody today. He had a conversation with a couple of people a couple of hours before he had had this conversation with me. And he had asked these people, do you not know what it is to feel the presence of God? They said, no, that's not for the time today. That is only for Bible time. That's not for the here and now. That's not for right now. That was only way back then. And so this guy that's talking to me, he said, you mean to tell me you honestly don't know what it is? You don't know what it means? You do not understand what it is to feel the presence of God? They said, no. They don't. This is their response. They said, we don't want our salvation based on our feeling. I get all of that. The Bible tells us we walk by faith and not by sight. I'm not walking by my feelings. I don't feel good, but I'm coming to church anyway, right? I don't feel like worshiping, but I'm worshiping God anyway. I don't feel like doing, but I'm worshiping God anyway. So what we've got to realize and understand is the fact that it's not my salvation is not based on my feeling. My salvation is my faith in Jesus Christ and that he shed his blood on the cross of Calvary and he paid a debt that I could not pay. That's what my faith is. My salvation is built on that faith. And therefore, I get to feel the presence of God. I may not feel the presence of God, but I know that I've got faith that God's still there. How many has ever seen the wind in action? You've seen the wind. Have you seen the wind? You've seen the wind blow. You've seen the wind blow the me and Brother George Masters. We was out here one day. We're blowing the leaves across the parking lot. We both got leaf blowers and we're blowing the leaves this way. And all of a sudden, I'm gonna tell y'all right now, God's got a great sense of humor. He loves to pour his sense of humor out on me all the time. So we're going down through here. We're blowing those leaves this away, and all of a sudden, a wind comes this away and blows all those leaves back up on us. I don't see the wind. I've seen the effects of the wind. There might be times that I don't feel God's presence, but I see God's presence. Does that make sense? And what we've got to realize and understand, there is a difference. And so my salvation is not based on my feeling. My salvation is based on my faith in Jesus Christ. Amen? You had to understand that. The word of God is filled all throughout from front to back. Prayers, praying, exhortations to pray, results of prayer, examples of prayerfulness, and examples of prayerlessness. I didn't even know that was a word until I was typing it. Prayerlessness. The Old Testament heroes were men and women of God that knew how to pray. Do you know how I know that the Old Testament folks are men and women of God that knew how to get a hold of God? Because I'm going to tell you something. If I was Abram, I just really don't know that I could have got my son and said, "All right, come on, boy. We're going up a mountaintop." I really don't know that I could have done that unless I really knew that God had spoke. Does that make sense? He knew how to pray. He knew how to get a hold of God. And the Old Testament men and women, these are folks that knows how to pray. These are heroes of the faith that knows how to pray. The apostles in the New Testament, they believed in prayer. They preached in prayer. They practiced prayer. Paul's letters are exhaustible in the subject of prayer. God originated prayer. God ordained prayer. God inspired prayer. God hears our prayers. God answers our prayer. God wants us to pray. And so the only way to pray is biblical praying. If we don't biblically pray, then what are we really doing? We're just... Anybody remember... Oh, man, the cartoon just left my brain. Charlie Brown. Anybody remember his teacher? If you're not biblically praying, that's basically what it sounds like. We've got to know how to intelligently pray by the Word of God. Now, I'm going to stop right there because I want to throw this out here because I need you to understand this too. I've had people say, "I don't know how to pray." Do you know how to talk to your next door neighbor? Yeah. Talk to God. Just talk to God. Tell Him. Just talk to Him. Tell Him what's going on. Tell Him what's happening. Tell Him what's happening in your life. Tell Him the things that's happening. Because I'm going to tell you something. The Bible does tell us, ask and it shall be given. You have not because you ask not. And so we've got to realize and understand, God is just wanting us to have communication with Him. Amen? So, scriptural praying is the right way to pray. So, really quickly, because I don't want us to stay on this part right here, is we need to know how to not pray. We do need to know how to not pray, right? If you know how to not drive, you don't drive that well. Some really... I don't think somebody told some of these folks that drives on the interstate how not to drive, but they drive it that way anyway. But anyway, so we need to know how to not pray. So what's some things that we don't need to do when we pray? What are some things that we don't need to do when we pray? Well, we take a look at Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6 is one of the strongest how-to chapters in the Bible. It teaches us how to give. It teaches us how to fast. Matthew chapter 6 teaches us how to handle our money. Matthew chapter 6 teaches us how to be content. Matthew chapter 6 is one of the strongest how-to. You want to know how to do something? Look at Matthew chapter 6. There's something in there that's going to help you in that. Matthew chapter 6 teaches us how to and how not to pray. So let's take a look at Matthew chapter 6, verse 5. Matthew 6 and verse 5, and it says this. "And when you pray, you do not be like the hypocrites." They love to stand and pray in the synagogues. Okay, notice first of all, they love to stand. So I'm going to pause right there because I want you, let's break this down and then I'm going to go back into this verse. I want you to see this. So when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites. So does anybody in here want to be like a hypocrite? No. If you're on live feed, you want to be like a hypocrite, let me know. If you want to be like a hypocrite, let me know. We don't want to be like hypocrites, right? So we don't need to do what the hypocrites do. So he goes on and he says, when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites. So whatever they do, we're going to do opposite, right? So it says, "For they love to stand." Okay, they love to stand, so I guess I don't need to stand when I pray. Hold that in your brain. Let's go on. "They pray in the synagogues." What is the synagogues? That's the church. So they love to pray in the church, so I guess we don't need to pray in the church at all. Let's go on. I got somewhere I'm going to go. Y'all just follow with me. Y'all thought I was crazy. Y'all fixing to find out. They love to stand. They love to pray in the synagogues. They pray at the street corners, so we don't need to pray on the street corners. We don't need to pray in the highways and the byways. And that they may be seen by others. Wait a minute. Huh. They love to stand. They love to pray in the church. They love to pray at the street corners that they may be seen by others. Huh. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. So I wonder what part of this verse that Jesus is actually referring to us and telling us, don't do that. Don't do like the hypocrites. Does anybody think that Jesus is saying, do not stand when you pray? No, he is not saying that. Jesus is not referring, he is not condemning praying while standing. It's not the position of your prayer, how your body positions, is not the context of this. It is not that process. I had a pastor friend of mine who's 91 years old when he told me this. He was sitting on this side of the church, front row, and I come in. He had let himself in the church. It was a Sunday night. The doors was already unlocked. He had already come in, and I come in, and he was sitting on the front row, and he was just praying. I didn't want to disturb him. I come all the way around this other side. I done some few things, and I got over to the altar, and I knelt down. I started praying, and we was praying. We always was praying before service that night, and so when I got up, I walked over to him, and he's just a crying. And I said, brother, what's going on? He said, I sure do wish I could get on my knees one more time and pray. I can't get down there. I said, I'm going to tell you something, brother. I said, I promise you, y'all can tell me I'm wrong if you want to. Y'all can tell me if I'm a heretic if you want to. But I can promise you, God hears his prayers, whether he's sitting on that front pew or he's sitting back there on that back pew or if he was knelt down, God hears all of them. Right? It's not the position that Jesus was concerned about the prayer. Jesus wasn't concerned about them standing or kneeling or laying prostrate before the Lord. There's examples of all of these in the Bible, but that was not the focus here. He was not saying, you've got to do this. He says, the standing is not the problem. So is it okay to stand and pray? Yes, it is. It's okay to stand and pray. That was not his issue. Jesus was not saying that praying in the synagogues or the church was the problem. Because I'm going to tell you something, if you can't pray to God in the church, where else can you pray? You know what I'm saying? Coming into the church house is not the problem to pray. I have said this before, and people can look at me like I'm crazy. They can tell me that I'm anti-Christian all day long. The facts of the matter is, everybody's hollering about getting prayer back into schools. I'm going to tell you something. I wish that prayer would be back in the church house and at the home place, because if it was there, it will be in the school. I don't care what Supreme Court says what. It'll be in the schoolhouse. It'll be in the courthouse. Why? Because people are going to pray. But it's got to start at the home and in the church house. So it wasn't the church house that Jesus was condemning the hypocrites about their prayer. Jesus does condemn the praying about being seen and about being just to be seen and just to be heard from mankind. If all you're doing is just praying out loud so that people can hear you, people can see you, that is what Jesus was condemning. It's not the position, but it is the spirit of prayer, the spirit of show, the spirit of display. Which one do you have? I don't know about you, but I want the spirit of prayer, not show and display. So we move down to verses 7 and verse 8. Matthew 6, 7 and 8. What else do we not need to do to pray? It's verse 7 and verse 8. It says this, and when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they will be heard for their many words. Just in case y'all didn't know, I'm a Gentile. I got many words. So is he condemning the many words? No. Watch this. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. So is Jesus saying that if you say a lot of words, that if you pray for a long amount of time, is that what Jesus is saying, that that's the problem? No. Remember, Jesus went alone to pray, and he prayed for all night. Remember, he prayed all night long. And I can promise you, he didn't just repeat himself over and over and over and over again. He prayed, and he prayed, and he prayed some more. Some of you have gone out to eat with us when we go somewhere to eat. And who do we always, when we go eat, who do we always get to pray over our meal?
Katie.
Why?
God bless this food, amen. They ain't many words on the praying. Why? Because Katie is just like her daddy, hungry 24/7. I'm not about praying for 14 hours and letting the food get cold. Pray over the food and let's eat. Right? Oh, Brother Andy, but what if somebody needs to get saved right there? Well, you know what? If they need to get saved, I'll push my plate back and we'll just have a Holy Ghost fit right in the middle of the restaurant. We'll get somebody saved. We'll get them baptized in the Holy Ghost right in the middle of the restaurant. We'll let them knock rice all over the place if we have to. I don't care. But I want you to hear this, and I don't want you to take my words out of context. But when I'm praying over my meal, that's not the time for me to pray that God forgive me of my sins. Now, if I've got sins in my life, then I need to get a hold of God and pray for my sins. Amen? What we need to understand is when we're on an airplane flying at 30,000 feet and the pilot comes across the radio and he says, "Passengers, hold on to your life vest. We're going down." I'm not going to be sitting there praying that God will bless my finances. I'm not going to be, God, make sure my life insurance is paid up. I'm not praying over making, you know, I'm praying, God, you better crank that engine back up. Do you hear what I'm saying? So what am I saying? There's times that we don't pray for salvation. You need to understand up front, any time is the good time to pray over salvation. But I also want us to understand is I'm going to be prayed up, ready to meet my maker, as some say. I'm prayed up, ready to go. And so therefore, when it's time to eat, I'm praying over my food and I'm going to start eating. This is what Jesus was referring to. These folks that was getting out there to pray just to have words to say. Now, if that's all you're repeating words just to repeat the words, then that's not biblical praying. That's not what that is. That's just babbling. That's the babbling time. Christ warns us not to just... Now, okay, before I go any further, did anybody hear me say that there's times not to pray for salvation? Did anybody hear me say that? Nobody heard that. I don't want anybody to mistake that anything of what I just said is a time not to pray for salvation, because that's not what I said. What I am saying is this. We need to know that we're getting a hold of God. When my feet hit the floor in the morning, I want to know that I'm going to get a hold of God. I want to know that he's going to answer when I call. I got to hurry up because I got something I want to really give to y'all. You can go ahead and turn over to Matthew chapter 6, verse 9. And I know, because that's where I'm going next. But just hang on to this. Watch. Christ warns us not to just use empty words or phrases over and over again. Some people believe by repeating their words. Now, husbands, this is not your wife repeating what she's told you a dozen times. That's not what this is referring to either, okay? So, wives, if I need to repeat that to your husbands, just let me know. I'll be glad to text it to them and say, you said, never mind. Some people believe by repeating their words and prayers over and over and over and over and over and over and over again that their prayers are going to be answered. Jesus does not say that much praying is wrong, nor did he say that repeating the same words, phrases, and thoughts was wrong. Jesus is saying continual babbling about things that are irrelevant and senseless, that's what's wrong. Do you know what's happening wrong in the church world? Too many people are arguing over the color of the walls, and nobody's praying that somebody will get saved. People are getting mad over the color of the carpet, over the fragrance of the soap that's in the girls' bathroom, and nobody's concerned about people coming to an altar and praying.
I don't really give a flying flip what fragrance is in the is on the soap in the bathroom. I don't even know what the fragrance is. I don't care about that. What I do care about is getting a hold of God for God to touch somebody's heart and their life. And let's get a hold of God that somebody will be saved. Somebody's life will be changed. Amen? That's what is this is all about. Let's go on. Verse 9 through 13. Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 through 13. It says this. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For anybody says anything, somebody's going to say there's a line missing. There's not a line missing. Many of the oldest manuscripts of the Greek do not have the line, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. That's not in the oldest Greek translations that we have. That line is not there. It was added. I've got somewhere I'm going. I'm not trying to get anybody confused or upset or somebody holler, I'm a heretic here. I've got somewhere I'm going with this. There's a reason why I'm doing this. Most of the oldest manuscripts of the Greek do not have that line. You notice it's not on the screen. I didn't even put verse 14 on there, but you flip to verse 14, it doesn't have that line. That line's not on there. In the King James Version, verse 14 is not this. 13, the last part of 13 has that line, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. That's in the last part of 13. But most of the oldest manuscripts of Greek do not have that line. But most Bible scholars believe that line was added at a later time to be used for public worship. This is what I'm bringing out. This line was added to be used for public worship. Nobody added to the Bible. Nobody taken away from the Bible. Nobody is causing themselves for hellfire and damnation. That's not what's going on here. They added this line for public worship. The meaning of these verses has not changed. Jesus is quoting a verse. He's quoting 1 Corinthians chapter 29 and verse 11. Look at 1 Corinthians 29 and verse 11. What we've just talked about, and then 1 Corinthians 29 and verse 11, which is where Jesus is pulling something from. 1 Corinthians 29 and 11. Yours, O Lord, is the greatest and the power, the glory, the victory, the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. What these verses have in common is one thing. And this is the part of biblical worship that you've got to grab a hold of. This is the part of biblical worship or biblical prayer that we've got to grasp a hold of. What the Bible is referring to is not, it's about worship when we go to God in prayer. It's about worshiping our Heavenly Father. The point of these verses is this: God owns everything. Everything belongs to God. Your job belongs to God. Your car that's broken down sitting in your front yard belongs to God. Hello? Everything that is existence belongs to God. So what does that mean for us? Learning biblical prayer. What does that mean for our lives? God is the source of the kingdom, the power, and the glory. It also means that God is the possessor of the kingdom, the power, and the glory. It also means that God is the recipient of the kingdom, the power, and the glory. God owns it all. God is the source of it all. God is the possessor of it all. God is the recipient of it all. How many times do we stop? How many times do we step back and we say, oh, look, hello? Nobody's got to say you've done it. I've done it, okay? I've sat at the kitchen table, and I've laid the bills out. I'm looking at the check register. Yeah, everybody in here should know what a check register is. I looked, and I was, if it had been, Brother Tony, if it had been some teenagers in here, I'd had to. But I have sat there at the kitchen table, and I've had the bills laid there. I've had the checkbooks registered there, and I'm saying, okay, God, this is what's in the bank account. This is the bills. They ain't enough in the bank account to pay the bills. What you going to do? Hello? I've said, what you going to do? Lisa, I've said, here's the bills. Here's the money. What you gonna do? Why? Because it ain't mine. It belongs to God. My money don't belong to me. It belongs to God. So I'm saying, okay, God, what are you gonna do to pay all these bills? My job don't belong to me. My job belongs to God. My vehicles don't belong to me. They belong to God. The things that I've got in my life don't belong to me. They belong to God. When we get that concept in our mindset, we limit God, but we need to let God go. We need to let God do what God wants to do. We don't need to try to keep God in a box. We need to let God work. We need to let God stretch his legs. We need to let God stretch out and let God show people God is still in charge. Our car, the blue car, Our car has been paid for a little over 5 years. It's been paid for a minute, okay? It's been paid for a while. I got a big old check the other day from the mortgage, from the finance company where the car was financed through. I say big old check, very sarcastically. It was $4.01. $4.01. But the point is I got $4.01 from an unusual source. How many is expecting your vehicle to be paid for and you get a refund check? It's been not just a month, not just 2 months, for almost a little over 5 years that car's been paid for, and I got a refund check for $4.01. I know it's comical. It ain't a whole lot. You ain't going to buy a whole lot with $4.01. But you know what? That's just like God. You know what that just shows me? God says, hey, that mortgage company don't even own the money that they think they own. I just sent you a $4.01 check just to show you I can do it. Hello? That's the way I take it. Do you know what I also got in the mail on the same day? A $30 check from the mortgage company. I got two in one day. Hey, it was $30, but you know. So I got $34.01 in one day that was an unexpected source. But guess what? That is God saying, hey, people think they're in charge, but I need them to understand I'm still in charge. And when we get that in our mindset, hey, how much easier is it to pray when we know that God is going to take care of it? It's hard to go to your boss and say, I need a raise whenever your boss is just running around saying, you know what, if we don't, okay, if you're working at a job and you go to and you hear the boss all the time saying, if something doesn't happen, I'm fixing to have to lay off 15 people and you're first. You're not going in the next day and say, I need a raise, are you? But you know what? My boss, he owns the cattle of 1,000 hills. Hello? My boss lives in a place where the streets of gold and the gates of pearl. I don't have a problem going to God and say, hey, God, here's the bills. What you going to do about it? Why? Because I know that my God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that I could ever hope or imagine to pay for those bills. That's not outside the premise of what my God can do. Knowing these verses that we just read, Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 through 13, 1 Corinthians chapter 29, verse 11, knowing these verses are telling us we must understand that when we pray as a believer, when you come to an altar to pray, when you're in your vehicle going down the road, you're praying, when you're in your prayer closet to pray, whenever you're going to God and pray, if you are doubting, you're wasting your breath. Do y'all hear me? I need to go to God knowing that God is going to answer that need. I need to go to God knowing God's going to take care of that. Me and Ronnie would get in the truck and we'd go to Birmingham. We'd go to the VA hospital. Ronnie would tell me, you know what? I want a red convertible. I want a red monster truck. I want, you know what? Ronnie, you barking up the wrong tree. That's exactly what I tell him. You can't afford it, neither can I. But he sure did have wishful, wild, big dreams. I'm just going ahead and telling y'all right now. But the fact of the matter was, is he also knew, he said, you know what? He said, I don't know why God has kept me around as long as he has. Why he hasn't already taken me home. Why he allowed this to happen to this person, this to happen to this person, and I'm still here. They're a whole lot bigger in the faith than I am. Why am I still here? I said, you got a work to do for God. I'm going to tell you something. Ronnie could do a work for God. He got up there huffing and puffing. He's like, I'm glad they gone. I was fixing to whoop them with this shovel. Here's the point that we've got to understand. When we go to God in prayer, we've got to go to God as a believer. We need to know that we belong to God. I belong to God. I am a child of God. I am a victor, not a defeated person. I need to go to God knowing that I am on the winning side. As a believer, I belong to the kingdom of God. Hello? As a believer, I belong to the kingdom of God. God has accepted me into the kingdom of God and promises me everlasting life in his kingdom upon my death or his return. I belong to the kingdom of God. As a believer, I belong to God's power. Hello? There ain't nothing that God can't do. There's a lot of things I can't do, but they ain't nothing that my God. Hello? I belong to the power of God. God has delivered me from sin and death, and he continues to deliver me every day. I belong to the power of God. I belong to the glory of God. God has done all for me. I can never thank him for what he's done. But he gets the honor and the glory for everything that's been accomplished. Last verse, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 7. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 7. Look at what it says. So that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Quit putting limits on God and let God work in our lives. I can't tell you how many times I've heard churches, lots of church consulting going on. I've had so many churches, Bible-believing churches, and say, we can't do that. You might not can, but my God can. Hello? I've talked to children of God, and they'll say, I can't do that. You might not can, but my God can. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. Artifacts on x-rays, they can explain them away all day long. I got two words for you, but God. Echoes on MRIs and CAT scans, they can explain them all day long, but God. Abnormalities in blood work, they can explain it all day long, but God. Well, you know, if you know that car wreck, you know, if if this would have happened and this would have happened and this would have happened, this would have happened, you'd been dead. But God. I've seen people walk away from wrecks and they didn't have a seatbelt on. And I've seen people at the exact, almost the exact same wreck have a seatbelt on and die. I've seen people that had seatbelts on and walk away and not seatbelts on, die. I can't explain, but all I can say is, but God. Man might try to explain a lot of things away. We've got to have the physics and we got to have the scientific method. We got to have this and we got to have that. But God. Do you know who created gravity? God. Do you know who created the chemistry? God. Do you know who created the scientific method? God. Do you know who created the heavens and the earth? God. I don't know about you, but biblical praying, praying intelligently, is knowing that my God is able. My God is able. I'm going to God knowing that God is able to move. God, there's a song. God likes to work when nothing else will. I love that. It's not about what I can do. It's not about what you can do. But God. Amen. Live feed, thank you so much for joining with us. Join us back Sunday school, Sunday morning at 9:45. Worship at 11. May the good Lord bless you is our prayer. Amen and amen.